Hi, I'm Richard Jacques. I'm a video game composer and I'm here today at Abbey Road Studios. My musical background is quite eclectic. I was fortunate to come from a musical family, so I started playing the piano when I was 5 years old, and then I started trombone when I was seven. And then from the age of about 12, I was attending the Royal Academy of Music in London for my Saturday music school, so playing in orchestras, things like that. And then at the age of 16, I went to Wells Cathedral School in Somerset, which is a specialist music school here in the UK. And then I went and did a music degree as well at university. And all around that time, I was also learning jazz and DJing and playing with electronic music as well. So it's quite a broad upbringing. Video game scoring is a very interesting one because when I was a student, I assumed that all video games were made in Japan because we're going back to the sort of early to mid 90s. And I've been playing games since I was a kid, since I was about 11 years old. So I've been into games a long time. And then when I was in my third year of university, I saw a job advertised at Sega, the Japanese video game company, and they wanted an in-house composer here in London. So I applied for the job and lucky enough, I got that. So I spent 7 or 8 really good years there working on all their IPs and creating music for their games. Scoring video games is very, very different from film and TV. Even though we're writing to picture, the actual process is quite different. So video games obviously are an interactive medium. So we have to think about exactly what the player is going to do at any given time. And because player choice is a big factor in games, the player could do literally anything. So I have to constantly think of all the avenues and the story arc that the player may or may not take, and to ensure that each section of the game is scored accordingly. So it's a huge kind of jigsaw puzzle that you have to think of right at the beginning in the planning stages. And then while I'm scoring it, I have to make sure that the emotion is correct in the right places to match all these branching storylines, and then remembering the overall story arc as well, so that we have a sort of good experience from beginning, middle to end. Recording a video game score is quite challenging because often we record the instrumental section separately. So I would always have strings, brass, wind, percussion, choir as separates because we want to change them interactively within the game. So we have to plan that very carefully. Obviously, we're going to need additional studio time because we're doing it separately. We also have to think about how it's all going to fit back together. So that's one consideration as well. If we're recording separately, making sure all the musicians can hear one another and they're playing to the various backing tracks. And also surround sound is now a huge part of video games. So whether we're going to record the sections for ambisonics or for Dolby Atmos, things like that. You know, we have to bear in mind all these things and then sort of a huge mixing session and then put it all back together in the game. Firstly, Abbey Road is so great to record because of the rooms. They just sound absolutely amazing, and that is one of the main factors why I come here so often. But another thing is the technical know-how as well. I mean, working on a video game soundtrack with, you know, huge amounts of music, sometimes 5, 6, or 7 hours of music with the best musicians in the world, we, you know, the clock's ticking, we need to get things done, and the technical staff are just so incredible. If there's any slight issue, it's resolved within seconds, and that makes a big difference when you have a big, complicated session. But also the history of the studio. I mean, you look at some of the scores that have been recorded here and it just kind of feels you're in this magical place, you know, hopefully contributing to that legacy. Gear and microphones are essential in any recording, but especially what we do in video games. So mic placement is essential because, as I said, we often do a lot of surround recording and we record in sections. So that is essential to get it right and to get it sounding, you know, representative of all these amazing musicians. So that's absolutely essential. And gear is as well, whether it's the Pro Tools system we're using, whether it's the converters, these things are absolutely key in getting that sound, and you can really tell the difference if it's not done right. So having access to that gear and that technology is essential. The shift in recording live orchestras for games started around the early to mid 90s. I believe the first one was probably done in Japan, but it soon started happening in the West. And the main thing that propelled it is really the storage medium. Back in the early 90s, we were still working on cartridge a lot, and as soon as the CD-ROM became the storage medium of choice, that changed everything. You know, we didn't have to rely on sort of substandard sound chips and FM synthesis. We could record live musicians or singers or bands. So naturally, orchestra recordings followed, and that's when it sort of really kicked off around that time. When I started working on Headhunter, I spoke with the director, and he wanted a sort of Hollywood type score, so I thought, well, we've got to record it at Abbey Road, that's how things are done properly. So once I had some meetings and submitted the budget and that was approved, I came to meet with the studio manager at the time, Colette Barber, and we talked about the sessions, and I met with Andrew Dudman, the engineer. So we planned the sessions a good sort of 6 months before, and then we recorded in January 2001 for 4 days with a 76-piece orchestra in Studio One. So it was a lot of planning. And I just knew that this is how you do things properly. We didn't want to do anything substandard, but really push the boundaries of what games are and what the industry is. So I thought, well, we just need the best musicians at the best studio and do things properly. And luckily, the results speak for themselves. During the Headhunter sessions, there was quite a lot of engineers involved. My main engineer was Matt Howe, who I'd worked with when he used to be at Metropolis, and he was freelance, and he was just my go-to choice because we'd had such a great relationship. We'd done a lot of games together. And then we had Andrew Dudman from Abbey Road. We had Richard Lancaster, who was at Abbey Road at the time, doing his Tom Meister. Then we had Ian Duncan on the Pro Tools. So there was a lot of people. It was quite a complex session because we were actually running two Pro Tools systems together. So a big technical job to do, and everyone really played their part. So when we recorded Headhunter, Matt Howe, the engineer, we were discussing gear, and he had already had a previous working relationship with Prism, especially Graham Boswell. So he suggested to me that there was this new technology just about to come on the market called the ADA8 converters. I didn't know a lot about them, but I trusted Matt implicitly. So I believe we were the first people to record an orchestra through the Prism converters, because they were literally about to go on the market a couple of weeks later. And as a result, the technical staff at Abbey Road had to listen to our recording the day after we finished. And I think the story goes that they ordered 48 of them pretty much on the spot. So it was a wonderful experience to have that new cutting edge technology to use on that recording session. We also had the Prism Masalec mic pres, which were a great companion. So we were really pushing the boundaries at the time, and it's great to see that Prisms have become sort of converter of choice for most people. So when I was asked to demo for James Bond 007 Bloodstone, I believe there were 6 or 7 composers in the mix. I think mostly American, I think one other British. And I thought to myself, well, hang on a minute. James Bond as a character is British and needs to stay British, the score. So I took quite a big risk, and I hired all the musicians that play on films for my demo. We recorded it in Studio 2. So what you hear on the movies is exactly what you hear on my demo. During the Bond sessions, one particular highlight was when the late, great Derek Watkins, lead trumpet, came into the control room. We just finished a take, and obviously I know he is a very, very high player, which is where you get that sound, that really high piercing trumpet sound. So I wrote it accordingly in the higher register, and we just finished a take, and he said, Richard, can I come and have a listen? So I said, yeah. And he goes, do you want the octave on that? And I said, no, we've already recorded it, here it is. And he just said, no, the one above. So he went back down and did a whole octave above what I'd already written, and it was just absolutely incredible. Working on Marvel's Guardians of the Galaxy was definitely a career highlight and my biggest project to date. So we had over 5 hours of music in the game, which is the biggest project I've ever scored single-handedly. And the recordings will be no different, so we had to plan them quite far in advance, because we needed, I think it was 11 days block booking, and to get that at a busy studio such as Abbey Road is no mean feat. I think the choir was a real highlight session for me as well, because I wrote a lot of choral effects. So there was a lot of traditional choral scoring, but there was a lot of effects for one of the characters in Marvel's Guardians of the Galaxy. So there was a lot of kind of demonic whispering and guttural throaty sound. Seeing the singers perform these effects, it just came to life and it gave it a whole other dimension. Since the game was released, I've been very privileged and humbled to have received many awards and nominations as well. The Ivor Novello for Best Original Video Game Score was definitely one of the best days of my life, because that award's so important, because it's all about composers and songwriters. It's just all about the people that craft the music and all the songs. So receiving that was just a huge, huge honour. And then going on from that, it just kept going and going with BAFTA, and then the Grammys was the first year ever that they had a video game category for Best Original Video Game Score. And I wasn't really thinking a lot about it, because I know it's, you know, based in the States, and I didn't know what the competition was going to be like. So when the nominations were read out in November, I was I just had a meeting with the director of the game previously in the day, and we said, oh, we'll watch it, you know, just to see. And then the first one, the second one, third one, and then my name in the game was read out and I couldn't quite believe it. The fact that the Ivors, BAFTA and the Grammys now take this art form seriously, it's kind of about time, but it's really good that they do, because it is different what we do. As I previously said, it's not as straightforward as film or TV, although I know that also has its challenges. But to be recognised as an industry, and for me personally, for my score to Marvel's Guardians of the Galaxy, was just the absolute icing on the cake. I think VR is going to be an even bigger thing in the future. You know, it's around now, but I think the way the technology is evolving, especially within games, is a really exciting prospect. So we've got all this amazing surround sound recording as well now, but when we're using that with head trackers and various VR kind of technologies, it makes the game even more immersive. So I think that's a really interesting one to watch and see how that develops. And I think that will really continue to push boundaries. So at the moment I've been working a lot on Overwatch 2 for Blizzard, which is a constantly updated live service game. It's been great fun working with Blizzard. They're a great team, very easy to work with. There's a number of composers on that, so we sort of share the load. And then I've just, in the very, very early stages of a brand new exciting project, which unfortunately I can't talk about due to my NDA. But let's just say, look out for it around 2027.